The next item of business is consideration of business motion 14533 in the name of Jamie Hepburn on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau on changes to business. Any member who wishes to speak to the motion should press their request to speak button now, and I call on Jamie Hepburn to move the motion.
Move, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Minister. No member has asked to speak to the motion. Therefore, the question is that motion 14533 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motion is therefore agreed. The next item of business is topical questions. And at question number one, I call Claire Baker.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on what discussions it has had with Harland and Wolff regarding the future of its construction yards at Methil and Arnish.
Deputy First Minister.
I met with Russell Downes, the interim executive chairman, on the 2nd of September, alongside the local management of both yards. We discussed the ongoing refinancing of the business, the options for a sale and the engagement that the business is having with the workforce. And my officials and the enterprise agencies remain in very regular contact with the business and with unions as well. And all of our collective effort is focused on achieving the best outcome for the business and its workforce. The Scottish sites continue to operate, and that was communicated by the business yesterday.
Claire Baker.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that update and would urge her to continue talks with the trade unions in particular, because those employed at the Methil yard, this is not the first time they have faced this level of uncertainty. The yards do have a skilled and dedicated workforce, including a number of apprentices, and the hope and the aim here is that they will continue working under new ownership. So what reassurances can the Cabinet Secretary offer to these workers at this time, and what is it doing to ensure these opportunities can continue to exist on a longer term basis?
Deputy First Minister.
Well, the member is absolutely right to praise the workforce and the skills of the workforce. I will continue to engage with the trade unions as she recommends. We're also engaging with the UK government. I've had a number of conversations with various secretaries of state, actually, about Harland and Wolff, and with the business, as I said. Ultimately, she'll know that it's up to the management team and investors within the business to work through the commercial options to provide a sustainable future for the organisation on the workforce, and the business is fully aware of the interest and scrutiny of both governments, and the management are working closely with us and with the UK government.
Claire Baker.
I welcome the Cabinet Secretary's comments about working with the UK Government, and if we are to have a future for these yards, it's important that governments continue to work together, because the yard does have huge potential and strategic importance when it comes to delivering on Scotland's net zero ambitions, but it does face limitations in terms of its infrastructure investment. The yard is owned by Scottish Enterprise, and I'd like to know if the Government have made any evaluation of the yard and what could be done to help it be a more viable option and help it to compete on an international basis.
Deputy First Minister.
The member is right that the enterprise agencies own the sites, and they have been working closely with the business and with the financial advisers Rothschild to ensure that they can analyse the most sustainable opportunities for the business and how the enterprise agencies can support the ambition and communicate that effectively to potential new parties. So I would reassure the member that we see significant opportunities across Scotland in terms of our industrial assets. There is a point here at which some decisions need to be made on a commercial basis first, but there's certainly no lack of engagement, no lack of interest, and no lack of willingness to ensure that there is a sustainable future for both sites in Scotland.
David Torrance.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And I take heed of the Cabinet Secretary's comments. To go back to the yard and the facilities in the yard, and it is owned by Scottish Enterprise, any of my dealings with the management or with the unions on the site have really emphasised that the yard and the facilities are key to any future investment. So can the Cabinet Secretary say what we could do to attract future buyers and investment in the site?
Deputy First Minister.
Well, David Torrance sets out a number of important issues. There are a number of commercial decisions to be taken by the business. None of those will be taken lightly. The board has reprioritised activities to protect its core operations, which include Arnish and Methil yards, which I understand is in David Torrance's constituency. As I already outlined, we are in regular contact with both trade unions on the issues concerning the business and are keen to understand where we can add value and support the business.
Tim Eagle.
Officer, the Deputy First Minister might be aware that last week, similar to Harland and Wolff, Bakkafrost announced that they were making 74 staff redundant at their processing facility in Marybank and Arnish, also in Stornoway. What action is the Scottish Government, if any, taking to support the affected staff? And has it had any engagement with Bakkafrost over this sad development?
Deputy First Minister, on the points with regards to relevance of the substantive question.
I'm not sure that is relevant to Harland and Wolff, but I will say to the member that we are engaging quite extensively, and Marie Goujon in particular has engaged with the company, including in the Faroe Islands. So we want to ensure that there's a long-term future, and where this does relate to Harland and Wolff is that all of us want to see a reversal of depopulation in our islands, and that comes about through well-paid, secure jobs. The member has mentioned one of those employers, and Harland Wolff would be another.
Mark Ruskell.
Thank you. This is the second time in 3 years that workers at the Methil Yard have faced a very uncertain future. The yard at Methil was previously on a long list for a portion of that £500 million investment in Scotland's offshore wind supply chain. So can the Cabinet Secretary confirm whether the Government has explored all options to really lock Methil Yard into that supply chain for the future? And can she also give a commitment that any investments that come through the Green Freeport will not undermine the case for investment at Methil, but indeed will work alongside that to really strengthen that supply chain that we need to see grow in the east of Scotland?
Deputy First Minister.
In terms of specifically the site at Methil, the business is continuing to seek commercial options. There have been no specific formal requests from the business to government at this point, but we'll continue that dialogue. There are opportunities for a number of sites in Scotland. The member referenced the strategic investment of up to £500 million to anchor the offshore wind supply chain in Scotland. I would certainly see no risk from the Green Freeport to Methil, only increasing the commercial opportunities that might be available to support the site.
Daniel Johnson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. From Grangemouth to Alexander Dennis and to Harland and Wolff, I think the last week has demonstrated in very brutal terms that the energy transition will not necessarily be smooth. I think in particular to Harland and Wolff, what seems to be is that the demand we know that will be there is not there yet. So I was wondering what the Scottish Government is looking at in terms of smoothing order books so that we can build the capacity that we know we'll need in terms of fabrication engineering to build the infrastructure required for renewable energy sources.
Deputy First Minister.
That is certainly ongoing, and the member is right to say that the whole point of the transition is that things are done sequentially to support the workforce as far as possible and to indeed create new opportunities. And that's the approach that we are taking to all the sites that he referenced. In terms of Harland and Wolff, we are conscious that there are economic opportunities out there, and we are keen to support the yard in securing those commercial opportunities. There is Scottish Government support available through the enterprise agencies, but also in terms of the £500 million for developing the supply chain, as well as the Scottish Offshore Wind Energy Council's strategic investment model. So there are schemes out there. I suppose the point we would make, and this is a point that the business have made both the UK Government and to ourselves, is that the request must come from the business in terms of what works for them. And we will continue to engage with trade unions to make sure we are fully cited on what would support the workforce.
Question number two, Sue Webber.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what its response is to the recent independent inquiry carried out by Vicky Ling into the Edinburgh Rape Crisis Centre and the subsequent resignation of its chief executive, Mrudal Vada.
Minister Kocab-Stewart.
Thank you. The needs and safety of survivors of rape and sexual assault must be the utmost priority of support services. It is totally unacceptable, as the report makes clear, that survivors were let down by a core failure of Edinburgh Rape Crisis Centre to deliver services to NSS standards. This report highlights important areas where action is needed to ensure survivors can confidently continue to access support from the Edinburgh Rape Crisis Centre. And I welcome the intention of the Centre's board to implement all of the recommendations. The employment decisions of the ERCC are a matter for the board, and I cannot comment on individual cases. And I do hope that the board and the interim CEO are now in place and can be given the space to continue to rebuild the service and confidence within it.
Sue Webber.
I thank the Minister for that response. But the truth is, Minister, that Edinburgh Rape Crisis Centre and Rape Crisis Scotland have been reliant on Scottish Government funding in recent years. The Scottish Government dismissed those with gender-critical beliefs, and this attitude has filtered down to organisations dependent on their funding. This has led to the extraordinary situation where Rape Crisis Scotland and others came out in support of the SNP's Gender Self-ID Bill and condemned critics for spreading apparent misinformation. If Edinburgh Rape Crisis Centre and Rape Crisis Scotland are to change their culture, so too must the Scottish Government. So will the Minister commit to a complete reset of this Government's priorities so that women's safety, rather than gender ideology, takes precedence when it comes to tackling violence against women and girls?
Minister.
Women's safety is paramount for the Scottish Government, and we do continue to fund the Edinburgh Rape Crisis Centre to support survivors of rape and sexual assault, as we do for rape crisis centres across the country, as this funding is needed for the vital work done to support survivors. The Scottish Government can discontinue funding if those funds are not used in line with the conditions of the grant being met. Vicky Lynn's report highlights the positive impact of the services provided by Edinburgh Rape Crisis to a significant number of survivors who have used their services. Our fund manager, Inspiring Scotland, will continue to work with the board of ERCC as they implement the necessary changes recommended by Vicky Lynn's report.
Sue Webber.
Minister, the independent report was scathing. It stated that ERCC did not put survivors first. And this shocking revelation forced the CEO to resign over the weekend. But she previously said that survivors should be challenged on their prejudices. But the ERCC's culture of ostracising those with gender-critical beliefs was enabled by Nicola Sturgeon, who described concerns about gender self-identification as not valid. So do you agree with me, Minister, that it's time for the leadership of ERCC to step down? And indeed, to allow for an entire change of culture, so too should the Chief Executive of Rape Crisis Scotland, who championed the very policies that have been the centre of this entire caustic situation.
Minister.
It is not for us as the Scottish Government to comment on individual organisations' employment and retention processes. The Board of Rape Crisis Scotland is responsible for all employment decisions of their staff.
Thank you. I call Ash Regan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Government unfortunately cannot continue to distance themselves from the situations that they're pushing a certain type of ideology and the circumstances that have arisen from that. The Government now really must provide some leadership on this, and I would like to know what action the Scottish Government will take immediately to investigate the reasons why oversight by Rape Crisis Scotland did not prevent a male from being employed across various different roles that have single-sex exemptions, which led to these egregious erosions of safeguarding, which allowed a now convicted sex offender to self-identify his access to rape trauma services, and the failure of that service then to support vulnerable women. The Government must show some leadership on this issue.
Minister.
Thank you. The Scottish Government strongly supports the separate and single-sex exemptions in the 2010 Act, which can allow for trans people to be excluded when this is a proportionate means of achieving a legitimate aim. It is the responsibility of the service providers to interpret and comply with the Equality Act. We would expect that the wishes of survivors about the sex of their support worker to be followed. I am pleased that the Edinburgh Rape Crisis Centre Board has publicly stated that single-sex provision has been reintroduced at the centre.
Rachel Hamilton.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. In response to the ERCC report, Rape Crisis Scotland stated that they had been concerned for 16 months that the Edinburgh Rape Crisis Centre, and I quote, did not provide dedicated women-only spaces as required by national service standards, while declaring to RCS that they were adhering to the standards. What can the Minister do to improve adherence and enforceability to Rape Crisis National Services Scotland, and can she confirm that all other 16 member rape crisis centres are currently providing dedicated women-only spaces?
Minister.
Thank you. The report did also highlight that whilst many service users also did receive an excellent service, whilst obviously some were significantly let down by the organisation. I've sort of lost track of the question, I'm afraid. The role of the government, as I stated in my previous questions, was through our funding, that legitimate route. We will continue to work with Inspiring Scotland to make sure that all the conditions are met. Thank you.
Faisal Chowdhury.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. We recognise this is a damning report on organisation which should be providing a vital service to women during an incredibly difficult time. Female survivors should be treated with respect and choose what's best for them. All referrals to the service have now been stopped, leaving survivors with no help. Where will these women be directed to now? What action is the Scottish Government is taking to ensure women and girls in Edinburgh and Lothian can access this vital service?
Minister.
Rape Crisis Scotland continue to provide a service, and Mr Chowdhury is correct in that he says that no external referrals are being taken, but people, women, of course, can self-refer. And I would like to reiterate that violence against women is a fundamental violation of human rights and is totally unacceptable. We must root out that and tackle toxic masculinity and gender inequality that leads to violent harassment and misogyny and abuse against women. And we should stand against it and call it out when we see it.
Pam Gossel.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. During the debate on the Gender Recognition Reform Bill, I brought forward amendments which ensured that those seeking health care, such as cervical smears, can request to be treated by biological female staff. Unfortunately, these amendments were rejected by the SNP government. I have spoken to many survivors of male violence, many of which have expressed the importance of female counsellors and staff at rape crisis centres. Therefore, I ask the Minister, does she not believe that female victims of rape and sexual assault ought to know the biological sex of those offering them support?
Minister.
I am very, very sympathetic to the needs of survivors, and I do believe that they should have their needs put before anything else. I think I have stated that quite clearly. I would also like to remind Parliament that the Gender Recognition Reform Bill was not, in fact, enacted.
Thank you. That concludes topical questions. We will move on to the next item of business, and I'll allow just a moment or two for front benches to organise themselves.